Hello, everyone, and welcome to the OWASP DevSlop show. Today's episode is called Let's Write Security Unit Tests with Eric Johnson. In this talk, we will explore how security unit testing fits into DevOps, review a few unit testing frameworks, and go through several examples that can help security teams harden their applications. I am here with my co-host, Shanisa. Welcome, Shanisa.
Hello.
And she will introduce Eric.
All right. Yes, we have Eric Johnson, who's a co-founder and principal security engineer at Puma Security, where they focus on cloud security, static code analysis, and DevSecOps automation. Eric is also a senior instructor with the SANS Institute, where he authors information security courses on cloud security, DevSecOps, and secure coding. And you've probably seen him present his research at several conferences, including RSA B-Sides. Over to you, Eric.
Hey, all. Thank you for having me. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for jumping on. Hopefully the audio and video streams are okay on your side. Shoot a comment in if you're not hearing or seeing and all that fun stuff at any point, and I'll make sure that my configuration and setup is good. So with that, thanks for the intro, Shanisa. Let's dive in. I've got one intro slide here that I'll kind of gloss over quickly since you all did a fantastic job. I don't really need to say much more on this outside of contact info if you need to reach out or grab resources afterwards. You can find me at ejohnson at pumasecurity.io or on Twitter and LinkedIn. Handles and links and whatnot are on the right-hand part of this slide, which will be shared afterwards with you all. So I'll just get that out of the way up front. You'll be able to download them. They're already on SlideShare. So don't worry about trying to jot things down or, you know, try to frantically take notes or anything like that. It's way too early on a Sunday to feel like you're back in a classroom. So with that, let's take a peek at our agenda. We've got about an hour, so we should have plenty of time to actually do some demos and explore things with a little mini API application that we've got out on GitHub that we can play with for a bit. My goals here primarily is just to talk about where unit testing fits in the whole DevSecOps discussion as far as that methodology and workflow. And then I'll walk you through some unit testing 101 basics. If you have not written a unit test before, if you're not really familiar with the term, we'll quickly get you up to speed and show you how the time investment from a security perspective for learning how to write these and learning how to wedge them into the development workflow can be very beneficial from a security policy and requirements perspective. About midway through, we'll talk about, okay, let's shift from normal unit tests to the security mindset. And we'll take a look at what, you know, abuse cases and user stories can help you try to get creative and craft, you know, breaking unit tests or, you know, some evil user stories. And then we'll take a look at how that wedges into CI/CD pipelines. And I'll jump into some GitHub Actions and we'll take a look at a demo that I've got set up where we can actually start to see the security test cases failing and alerting the dev teams that something super evil is going on inside of their application. So that's the whole layout for this morning. Hopefully that sounds interesting. The first, and this is just a one slide overview that I typically show in DevSecOps discussions. The short story here is the end-to-end list of security controls that you have to include, you know, in a modern ecosystem is massive. And it's something that you can spend over a week plus discussing what that start to finish, shift left, all the way to shift right mentality looks like. Today, we are in one little bullet point on this slide. There's a lot of noise on here. And obviously, ask questions about any of this stuff if you want. But today we're focusing just on unit testing, which really is more of a shift left piece to the puzzle, where in the pre-commit phase, as we're just writing code, you know, in VS Code or in Sublime or whatever editor you like, and then looking into the more of the commit phase where we're starting to kick off pipelines and we'll execute and validate those to make sure that all those test cases are passing and or failing as expected. And we'll get into the difference between a positive and a negative test case here in a little bit. So that's where we're sitting, at least on the whole control side. Let's jump into unit testing 101 here. As you look at just the developer workflow, now my personal background, I spent about 3 to 4 years in enterprise level development at a big financial institution here in the US. So we were writing code, web apps, you know, back in the early to mid 2000s that were running out there on the internet. And as we wrote code, we often would write these little unit tests, which exercised the code that we were writing. And the whole goal is when I go write a function, you know, let's just use a very simple example. Like think of a calculator, 1 plus 1. And you would write a unit test that sends in 1 plus 1 to the calculator, and you'd make sure that the answer that comes back is 2. And then if later I went to change the core functionality of this calculator to add some new feature, for example, you would rerun that unit test and you'd make sure that the bubble still lights up green. We want to make sure we didn't break something. So it started out as a way to just catch regressions as you would modify core functionality. This has, of course, expanded over the years. And now that we've got more modern frameworks able to inject mock services into kind of the testing ecosystem and memory. So think of a logging service, or think of a database backend that might need to be there for your system to function. You can start to inject all of these mock services into the unit test as it executes, and suddenly you're able to almost exercise an entire API. So I'll show you a little bit later how we've injected an in-memory database so the API can actually log in, validate credentials, return a JSON web token to you. We can create or register a new user. We can request data from the system. These are things that we can start to learn about how to set up from a dev and a security perspective to actually validate a lot of our requirements. And whether they're security requirements or normal kind of dev specific requirements, they're super powerful. The end goal, and everyone chases this, and no one probably really quite actually gets there, is to have what we would call 100% test coverage with your unit test suites. And there's some cool tools out there that help you measure. So when I run my unit testing framework, what percentage of my code actually was executed when I ran that full test suite? And the higher the percentage is, the higher your test coverage is, which means that if you change one line of code somewhere inside of this API, does the test cover that change and make sure that we didn't break something? So those are all foundational concepts inside of unit testing. From a security perspective, where it gets interesting is I would measure, well, what percentage of my security requirements are being exercised as part of the unit test suite as well. So things to think about as we dig forward a little bit here.
Yeah, and Eric, how did you find that collaboration to be between developers and security and maybe even your compliance team, you know, having input to those unit tests?
It's hard. And my next statement is going to be that this is not a very simple process to go through. You know, as security professionals, we know that all of our time is limited, right? We're often not focusing on one application specifically, but we might be focusing on suites of 100 or thousands of applications. And the reason that you see tools like static analysis and dynamic analysis kind of be the first layer of defense that we might throw at some of these systems is because we can kind of point, click, and shoot and scale. And unit testing is not that sort of process. It's important to realize this is manual threat modeling plus writing code. And these are very, very customized tests that we're going to actually put in place. So it requires a lot of collaboration between dev, who typically knows how to write or wire in the tests, right? Between security and compliance, who know what the requirements are and who might think of the more evil path for some of these test cases. And we've all got to work together to figure out how to build this up for this one application. And then we have to try to scale that afterwards, right? So this is a never-ending journey.
Yeah.
And one, it's underutilized, in my opinion. But there's a reason for it, because it takes so much engineering power to actually get it set up.
So question, if you're a security person or a security individual and you're talking to the development team and you say, hey, I think we should write some unit tests, you know, obviously there's all sorts of things to consider around where to start there, but where do you generically start? Is it like, let's just sort of test authentication? Is that like a good place to start? Or do you have any advice on how do you even begin this journey because it is so long and complicated?
Yeah, absolutely. And we'll get into this a little bit, but you jumped right on to, I've got a slide a little bit later that says, hey, from a security perspective, and something that I always talk about is identifying high risk code in whatever the system is. And that can be a very generic term, but authentication would fall into that category for me. And typically this starts with it's a bit of a threat modeling exercise, to be honest, to start with. What's this thing do? What data is inside of it? You know, what functionality does it perform? Do we have authentication? Do we have authorization? Do we have role or claim level entitlements going on? Things like that. In a 5 to 10 minute conversation, you probably in your head know, as a, you know, somebody familiar with just security and kind of doing threat modeling, where your first test cases are probably going to be targeting. Could be the auth system is where I would probably start. And we'll do some auth level demos here in a little bit. There's also some kind of generic unit tests that you can throw in there as well. You know, just think of like mini fuzzers.
Yeah.
If you want to look at it that way, let's throw, you know, these 12 characters at every parameter and make sure that they get blocked, something like that. You could argue that's not a unit test thing either. That's probably more of a zap sort of conversation, but you can also wedge that stuff in too, if you want to.
Cool. There's a few questions coming in the chat, but I don't want to steal your slide thunder here. So maybe.
Yeah, no worries. Let's we'll push forward, throw them out. If, especially if we get to one of those topics, we can maybe pause and chat about it again as well. The options for this very dependent on your language or your platform that you're working in. So this is also another reason, you know, as Shanisa said, you know, why this is difficult for security and ops to get into this is because suddenly you might have all of these in your organization and you kind of have to know all of them to work here, right?
So here's actually a really good spot for the question because I think it applies really nicely to this slide. Are there generic unit tests or templates that could be written across apps, or is it or is it challenging training testers to write them? So could you write generic unit tests that go across all of these platforms?
It's challenging to customize but be generic at the same time. So there is a framework, and I'll mention it. So Seth Law, who runs, co-hosts the Absolute AppSec podcast with Ken, he wrote a tool, and I remember seeing this over at, I think it was at Black Hat over in Singapore several years back. He wrote a tool called Sputter that I've got referenced on a slide coming up a little bit, which was like a security payload unit testing framework or something like that. I can't remember the exact name for the acronym, but that was what Seth tried to do with that project, which was to generically feed, you know, a YAML configuration into a framework that would then look at an application and spin up unit tests based on whatever the application was. So there's been some efforts to try to generic, make this more generic for sure. And while Seth, I think, made a really good start with that, I think he would be the first one to say, like, it's really, really hard. So if, in a lot of cases, you might cover some percentage of your requirements with a generic framework. But then as you really dig in and look at the application, you're going to have to write a custom test at some point where it's, you're going to have to learn whether it's, you know, Node.js and write a Mocha test, or you're going to have to go write a JUnit test for Java, or I've got most of ours in XUnit because we're a pretty heavy .NET shop. So you probably are going to have to deal with both regardless. So no silver bullet here, unfortunately. So one example, just because I'm going to show several of them as we kind of dig into the code and stuff like that. So in the .NET world, this is just an example. I've already got the application configured to basically configure itself based on what the real API would look like when you start it up, except instead of requiring a real database to be alive, it flips over to an in-memory database setting. and then it'll auto create and, you know, migrate the database schema over, et cetera, and seed some data into the database as the unit test framework starts up. So that's all sitting there ready to go. And now you can just start sending requests to the API. So this would be, if you're just working with a dev team, the first thing you're going to see is what I call a happy path in all cases. We're going to make sure that functionality works as intended. And in this case, we're acting, which is let's log in with a username and a password. And on the assertion side, am I getting a 200 response code back? And did it give me a JSON web token, which I would expect on that happy path? So that's a very simple example. Just did I log in correctly? That you'll probably find yourself in as a security or compliance person. The first time you go look at what tests are actually available, you're gonna have thousands of these things sitting there. So it then gets into your question about, you know, yes, there's generic things, but you also need to be able to read and understand what the individual tests are doing. Because oftentimes you could look at this as a security professional and say, okay, you've got one part of this covered, but what are we missing? Did we log in with an incorrect username and password and make sure that we don't get a JSON web token back? Or did we log in with root and make sure that that's just not even an allowed username? You kind of take those more evil use cases and you can just wedge them right in here and maybe execute this more than once with some positive and some negative test cases right there in line. So it's advantageous to be able to understand the individual frameworks because it can make it very simple to just extend what's already there. So we wrote some unit tests. How do you run them? All of them from the command line essentially will give you the ability to go into a directory and then run xunit, run junit, run moco, whatever it is. Typically it's just framework space test is the first thing I would start with. So yeah, .NET space test. Oh, cool. If you're in the directory with a bunch of unit tests in it, it's going to restore the packages, it's going to build the test project, and it's going to go execute all of the test cases that it finds inside of there. So I've walked into this, you know, hypothetical .NET Core API, or I guess it's .NET 6 now. We're not allowed to say core anymore, I don't think, but I probably can't undo the fact that that's what they made me call it for years. So apologies to any purists out there. But we found 11 test cases in this project, and you can see none failed, 11 passed. And those are all happy path test cases. That's kind of where we're starting as we dig into this thing. So let's pause here for a moment. I can open that up for additional questions if anything came in. What I was just going to simply show, and oh, this is a project which you all can go clone. It's an open source repo. So let me at least pop in here in our organization. So we've got a repo called Puma Prey, which is we use it for a lot of stuff internally at our company, but it's an open source repo. We have got a lot of static analysis rules that we scan this code with. It is not safe to run, I will say, in your production cloud environment. There are intentional vulnerabilities in here, lots of interesting libraries and misconfigurations to look at. So that's our target. And if you flip to, once you clone the repo, flip to the develop branch, which is where I've got kind of a lot of this work in progress that I put together for this discussion this morning. And inside of there, you'll notice that there's a source directory. That's where the API lives. So we've got this little .NET 5 API called Coyote. We name them all after random animals. And then the test directory is where we're kind of poking at this morning. So you'll see the coyote.test project. And in the develop branch, that's where those 11 unit tests live. And that's what we're executing. So as we pop in here and take a look in the test directory, you'll notice that we've got a feature directory, and that's where we'll just call those the happy path tests. That's where those are living at. So if you clone that repo down, you can take a peek. Some of the startup stuff is in here, and this is getting into more of the technical weeds a little bit, but we've got a base test harness in here. And this is probably more of a dev thing than a security thing, but I think it's important for us to all understand how you can configure these to be in a nice isolated in-memory kind of test environment as these things run. So in the .NET world, you've got a builder, and this startup configuration is pointing off to the main Coyote API class, and that's where authentication is configured, that's where password restrictions are configured, that's where the database connection is configured and all that fun stuff. If you want to go explore that and see what tests we might want to run here in a little bit. And the base address, you'll notice, instead of spinning up the API, you know, in a container for external requests to come in memory, we're just firing this thing up on localhost. So we can then have our unit tests hit this little virtual endpoint directly to exercise the framework, if that makes sense, or exercise the API. So all of that is sitting there ready to go. Let me just pop open one functional test case here as we dig into it. So you'll notice there's little API wrappers for all the endpoints. And here's my base endpoint that the first test is hitting. So we're just gonna hit /API/token. And we're going to submit an authentication request as this thing runs. So here's a send authentication request. It's taking a username and a password, and we're setting up, you know, just a little model object to send that off into the API. And then we're saying, hey, post to that endpoint the data and return the result. So that's the overall flow for whatever it is we're doing in here. It's going to go from the token API test suites. So here's just a couple of basic ones, right? Fail given the email is null. You know, we didn't actually give it a username. So we're going to call that method. And you can see here, so we're passing the null in and then some random password. And the unit test is then evaluating the status code, and we should get a 400 back and say, hey, that's an invalid request, et cetera. So you can go through, we've got what, five or six, as I pull this over a little bit. You know, this API is meant for, I think we set it up to show people safaris with lots of animals that they can, you know, register and go see. So you log in, you register for a safari, and then once you register, you can see all the cool animals that you would see if you went on the safari. So you'll notice there's a user controller, there's the JSON web token controller, we've got a safari and an animal controller, and then there's just a basic health check in there that's just pinging a little status endpoint, et cetera. So that's what you're gonna see on the develop branch. As you dig in there, so if you change into the, so notice I'm on the dev branch, you're in the test/coyote test directory, and then you can run, assuming you've got at least .NET 5 set up, you can just run .NET test, and they're quick. I mean, each controller test is usually sub-second in terms of how quickly these things run. And we've immediately, you know, we're gonna see out on the command line, hey, I ran those 11 test cases, total duration, you know, 535 milliseconds. That's pretty quick for executing tests and getting immediate feedback on, is this thing functioning? So that's at least where we're sitting on the, what it's gonna look like when you as a security professional start working with some of these teams. Hopefully that makes sense to everybody. And I know that's a lot of technical code stuff to look at in a short period of time. So take a moment to digest that a little bit as we look at where security can jump in here and start playing around as well.
And so if you wanted to take that a bit further, like, you know, authentication leads to a valid JWT, or successful authentication leads to a valid JWT token, you could probably assert or try to test for like what a brute force situation would look like. Like after 10 attempts, you get a CAPTCHA. Is this something that you could assert in a unit test?
Absolutely. And that's exactly where we will head, you know, as we start to look at what security policies we can jump in with here. You can put loops in these tests. So, you know, we just asserted a response code of 400 on a null username, right? There's nothing in there that says we can't make 10 requests at your authentication endpoint with an invalid username and password, and then assert that we get a CAPTCHA back, or we get a, you know, eventually maybe there's some other error code that indicates that your user's been locked out, for example. So those are the sorts of mind shifts that the devs aren't gonna typically take that leap, right? They're just worried about the code functioning appropriately. usually it takes a compliance or a security person to jump in and say, well, you've done a lot of cool work here, and I think we can start to build our defensibility up a little bit and start to satisfy some of our security policies just right there in a framework that you've already put together. You know, they've done the heavy lifting for us. Let's just make some small tweaks or some small extensions, and suddenly we're all working together to satisfy security requirements.
And to piggyback on that a little bit, Eric, so how do you distinguish what should go in your unit testing versus your other testing cycles? I know a lot of times when you start unit testing, the data that you're working with is not production quality. So what are your thoughts there on how you separate what's most important in unit tests versus those other stages?
The other stages are absolutely critical for security because you're right. Unit test, it is what it is. It's a mock kind of fake setup environment. So not everything fits in here. And we'll go through some of the ASVS requirements and some, you know, thoughts that I had as I read through some of them. Not everything fits here. So it's important to understand, again, it's not a silver bullet. This is a layer of defense that we're kind of throwing into the ecosystem. The way that I typically would do this, if it's one of my systems, is pretend that you just had a pen test done or some sort of vulnerability assessment, and you've got static analysis and dynamic analysis set up already. And those scans are to your satisfaction, right? And your pen test returns some high or critical finding. And what that tells you right out of the gate is there's a hole in your SAST and your DAST, right? It just completely missed this high or critical finding, which we know on the security side is typically going to be some sort of business logic flaw. It's going to be some sort of access control violation where I changed a 1 to an 8 in a URL and I got access to all of your records or whatever, right? Those are the things that I will immediately turn around and say, let's build this into a custom unit test, because clearly automation is missing that. That's where I think this truly fits into the puzzle, is to eliminate your false positives, or sorry, your false negatives from those automated scans. And you can do more, you know, it's easy to fall into this hole and never get out too, because you can literally just keep going and keep going and keep going. So maybe time box it a little bit to start with and then just slowly, incrementally improve from there. But it's good. That's a great question. And a lot of, we've mentioned almost all of this, I think, in passing at this point, which is great because we can just bust through this slide. I think the only one that we haven't thrown out there is the actual application security verification standards, which is a great OWASP project, in my opinion, for threat modeling and kind of benchmarking your systems to where, you know, we think they should be. You all have probably mentioned this a million times on this show, so I won't dig into the details of this, but I do use it. I read through it yesterday, you know, as I was drinking some coffee yesterday morning and said, well, I'm going to take this little Coyote service that one of our senior engineers, Andrew, threw together for, you know, a CTF for kind of running some scanning rules against it. And I'm just going to pick some requirements that I think fit really, really well and write unit tests for them. And so you'll see commits from yesterday. I just started throwing, well, let's hit like 5.2 and let's hit 3.4, because those are super simple to put together. And we'll walk through at least what those look like as we dig into how to run this stuff. Here's where we start. So the first thing we need to do is create some abuse cases and user stories. And those can be related to the ASVS. And then we can work with the dev teams to burn those into code. And we can then start to run those, whether it's from the command line or run them in CI/CD. Going back to I think that was the very first question from Nikki was, well, where do I start? You know, what's the most important code to start with? Here's your high-risk code candidates, in my opinion. It's probably bigger than this, but you know, we all have limited time. So here's, if I'm just going to do a very lightweight threat model of some system, I'm immediately looking for authentication, password handling, access control, crypto, any sort of user management or data entitlement checks. That's usually where you're going to find those business logic flaws that the other scanners are going to miss. because they're just essentially looking for evil data into a database query, evil data back out to a browser, right? They'll cover SQL injection and cross-site scripting very well for you. They're not really going to often evaluate your password lockout thresholds or do you have CAPTCHAs in place and things like that. So yeah, go ahead.
Question on these candidates. So let's just say you're using .NET and you're, you know, which we are in this context, and, you know, .NET purports to have a really good input validation engine around cross-site scripting. And when do you say to yourself, you know what, I trust the framework and I don't need to unit test on that because I'm using built-in framework defaults and I feel really confident that cross-site scripting is not possible on my application?
Yeah, I mean, it's good to know that those controls exist, right? And none of them are ever perfect. But in that context, you know, if we know that all of their views, or, you know, whether you're pumping data out to Angular or whatever, have pretty good cross-site scripting and coding capabilities built into them. So I'm probably not going to start with that and lean on my dynamic analysis tools just for the fuzzing aspect to manage that piece for me to start with.
Yeah.
Some of those things are configurable.
Sure.
So, you know, at least in the older versions of the framework, they kind of ripped out the request validation feature because it truly just didn't quite fit anyway. And a lot of people turned it off. And so your static analysis, a good one, will tell you if that's disabled somewhere inside of the system as well. Again, you know, you've got other tools there that are going to help you. And so in my opinion, from a unit test perspective, probably not where I'm starting either.
And I guess you could write unit tests to validate that you are using secure default like libraries, like SQL parameter, for example, right? So you're parameterizing all your queries. So that could be a better unit test than trying to actually, I don't know, fuzz the actual parameter, like validate that you're using the secure default.
And that's where it's, where Seth went with his Sputter, the payload unit test repository, is we know that there are certain character sets that cause exploits in those vulnerability categories, right? Think of like your tick marks, your less thans, your greater thans, your semicolons and things like that. And what Seth did was instead of running a full Zap scan, which we know takes a long time and it doesn't fit great into a CI/CD pipeline that has requirements of, you know, this thing's got to run in 5 minutes. If you throw Zap in there, you might've added 10 or 15 or 20 or who knows how long to that pipeline if you're running it in line, right? So what Seth did is he distilled those vulnerability categories down to here's 10 characters. And we're going to try to submit 10 characters into this field. And if any of these characters are allowed, we're going to fail the unit test. So you can set some of that stuff up. And that's super quick. I mean, you're talking a second or two to get that feedback. And we know that, well, we've got some weak validation here. And so that's the sort of context that I think we're really looking at in the unit test side is let's just cover a very small set of evil things and make sure that at least we're good there. Let the other deep dive tool manage the rest of it later, further on down the pipeline or, you know, out of band running every night or every weekend or something like that.
Makes sense.
But that's a good thought, right? We've got to make sure that we're applying the right technology for what it's designed to do and not try to take a unit test and turn it into a fuzzer at the same time.
Yeah, totally. And then you just get stuck there and you're kind of missing the larger point here, which is,
So we want to make sure we're solving the right problem with this. And a lot of folks will say, I don't know, if, you know, we'll just keep running our DAS scans against this. And I think that is why we see this underutilized, because there's a thin line where we're starting to go too far with it.
Totally. There's a question about what is declarative pipeline definitions on, the, on your
canvas. Let me go back. Yeah, so declarative pipeline definitions, it's a workflow file. So high-risk code, and I'm sure you all have seen some of the CI/CD breaches and things like that over the last year or two, right? And as you looked at you know, SolarWinds and like the code coverage breach and CI/CD pipelines are ripe for attackers to exploit systems. So in this context, if you've got a GitHub Action YAML file or a Jenkins file or, you know, an Azure DevOps pipeline file, something like that, that's actually defining what your workflow is in your system, to me, that's high risk code, because I can go in and if you have unit testing in here and you're expecting to evaluate the security of your system based on the passing or failing of those unit tests, what happens if me, the attacker, if I just go in and comment or remove that section of your pipeline out, suddenly that security control is gone, right? We just wiped it off the face of the planet. So even though we maybe don't have a great unit test framework for that, that's still something that we should be monitoring very closely for changes. And that's probably handled more through the pull request and the code owners side of things, just in version control in general, to make sure that that's not getting modified.
Yep. There's another question, comment. Well, I think it's a question, more of a comment. ASVS is a great way to tie types of tests overall. Add a column to your tool, SAS or DAS tools. Devs will see it as not covered. Add a unit test or do MPT to close coverage gap.
Oh, I love that for sure. And you've got that mentality in here. So let's just go forward a little bit. So I like the way that Scott worded that. So I took a look in the password section. You know, section 2 is all about kind of auth inside of this thing. And a lot of them are better, and some of them are going to be manual. It's also important to realize that some things can't really be automated from a test perspective. You might have to get human eyes on it. But I like the idea of having that grid and saying, here's which control I've got, you know, in my end-to-end workflow, the big slide from the beginning, right? And here's which control is going to satisfy that. So in section 2 yesterday, I just read through, I got into 2.1 and I saw 2.1.1, verify that user passwords are at least 12 characters. Static analysis, maybe we'll find that depending on how the application is configured and what rule sets they have. You might be able to figure out what the password length is. But sometimes that's being fed in as an external configuration value and the static analysis tool, well, it just can't know the answer, right? It's not a value that it can parse and evaluate on. Also, verify that passwords submitted during the account registration, login, etc., are checked against a set of breached passwords. That's also something that a static analysis tool is probably not going to really be able to figure out, not without a lot of customization. So I looked at both those, 2.1.1, 2.1.7, and said, okay, could a unit test do that? And I just showed you all how to check a positive path for a login, right? With a null or a valid username and password. So what does that look like if I actually wedge in a new test case to validate both of those? So I've mixed things up a little bit. And this was very subtle before. On line 1 with XUnit, I had the word fact up there. That was the attribute that says, this is a unit test, just run it. There's also a theory which allows you to supply kind of dynamic data on line 2 there. You see the inline data attribute, which those are now parameters that you can pass into the unit test. And that test will run 1 to many times, depending on how many inline datas you've got. So in theory, we could turn that first test into, okay, let's log in with the happy path, Eric, password 1, whatever. And we should get a 200 back for the status code. But notice line 2, now I'm throwing in some more advanced payloads here. So in this one, I've picked a password from the RockYou database list and the password's Tinkerbell. And Tinkerbell not only is a known breached password from, you know, a decade ago, but it also doesn't meet the ASVS requirement of a minimum of 12 either. So this kind of satisfies both. If this succeeds, we know that we've got some password construction problems inside of here. So notice the status code, it's not okay anymore. It's bad request. We should get an invalid registration screen or something like that here. And we go in, we use Tinkerbell, we try to create a user, and we should get a bad request 400 back. If it 200 comes back, that's bad. So it's almost the inverse logic of what the happy path would be. And that's as simple as just going through a couple of ASVS requirements saying, all right, let me throw, and this literally could be one line of code. If the unit test is set up right, we're going to add one more inline data to test the negative path. So that's kind of fun.
Yeah.
So hopefully that helps. I think it just really extends Scott's comment overall, and it says, yeah, I mean, we can check the box on those two. That's no problem. I jumped over into section 3, which is more session management, you know, token-based items are in 3.5, right? So we've got some tokens coming back and we're using those to authorize, you know, our access into different endpoints and things like that. So a couple requirements here, 3.5.2, I looked at and said, oh yeah, we can easily check that. You know, they're dynamic session-based tokens. They vary every time you log in, rather than using a static API key that's assigned to the user. So how would I unit test that? Well, let's log in twice and make sure that the token is not the same. Okay, make sure it's actually got some sort of a nonce or some sort of a random session ID inside of there that differentiates sessions. We can easily do that. Now, a dynamic tool could also do that. So there's going to be some overlap here. 3.5.3, I looked at that. Yeah, go ahead.
No, there's a question. I think this is perfect for rpsec_tech. How would you unit test code that does cryptography for security flaws, which I think is kind of correlated to token session management since.
If you think of traditional crypto vulnerabilities, right, there's a lot of just poor algorithm choices in there. So you could start to unit test, you know, if you've got a generic hashing algorithm, for example, and you see as you're reading through the dev side, you know, hey, run a crypto.hashme on some value. You could potentially evaluate the size that comes back and detect maybe I'm using MD5 or SHA-1 or something like that. So you can identify some weak algorithms there. You could also, in my head, it's screaming static analysis is better at this. So I'm trying not to go there. I'm thinking of kind of live evaluations. You could easily check padding for like padding Oracle attacks with the resulting tokens or the resulting ciphers you're getting back to check if things are running, you know, maybe in like CVC mode. Oh, where else could we look there? That might be the furthest I would go, I think, with unit testing crypto. I think there's other to identify misconfigurations there, but what else? Let me know if you can think of other things. It's kind of an interesting thought process.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I guess you're right. Like, you don't want to test the nature of the implementation of the cryptographic, whatever it is you're doing. It's not the right time for it. I guess it's really just, I don't know.
Yeah. And I guess I'll start with the system shouldn't be really doing its own crypto per se either. That should really just be leveraging a built-in library and using it. So you're really misconfigurations is where I would start with.
Yeah. And life cycling, like does the cookie actually get cleared, you know, when a user signs out or local storage or, you know, wherever you're storing material like that. And I guess,
yes,
maybe that's not really cryptography, but yeah.
Yeah. And section 3 covers a lot of that. I could have stopped in here for hours and, you know, I'm like, okay, let's log out. We'll replay the token and make sure that it doesn't work after I invoke the logout endpoint. There's a lot that you could do in here.
Yeah, the CSRF tokens, all of those tokens can be validated on.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So very basic. Now, CSRF would be hard to cover across the whole platform because suddenly you're invoking, you know, 400 endpoints with a token to make sure that they all like work or don't work. But it's easy to spot check some stuff as well.
Yes, absolutely,
Shanice. It's hard to keep in context what this is supposed to be used for and not go too far, which, you know, security people never overdo anything, do they?
Yeah, and as you're talking, I'm thinking of, you know, do you scan any open source code as part of your unit testing process? So not just your own code that you're building, but the other sources of what you're bringing into your environment. Again, how far do you go?
Yeah, you know, when you think of like Log4j, which very recently was a problem for a lot of us. That's not a, you know, I can't say that I didn't just throw a Log4j statement and a couple of queries, or you could easily just add another inline data to a validation type method to say, let's just throw a log4j thing in here just for giggles, make sure that we at least can start validating and blocking those down the road. So it can be that simple sometimes. let's see, the 353 I thought was fun. It's all about validating signatures, you know, so that's crypto-ish related. And I believe that's what I threw kind of into the next test case and said, all right, if I wanted to validate that the server-side API is going to make sure that a valid signature is attached to this JSON web token, how would I test that? And okay, we know we can log in. So we're going to log in and grab the JSON web token. And what we'd really want to do is, you know, look at lines, what, 9 through 12 on here. I said, well, let's just strip the signature off the token. So you're going to have your header of your JSON web token dot the payload dot, and then it's just empty after that. It's missing that signature. And let's play that through the endpoint. And let's see if the system rejects it based on that missing signature. That's a super quick little smoke test to make sure I didn't flip a bool from, you know, true to false on the back end is really ultimately what that boils down to. So that's a really easy one to make sure that we never misconfigure our JSON web token verification stuff. Just an example, pretty fun. Let's see, we've got, let me go through a couple more here real quick, and then we'll just start taking a look at this on the CI/CD side. We'll see what breaks in our Coyote app. Here's one that I use a lot, and it's just all about access control. This is, in my opinion, typically where the majority of static and dynamic analysis tools are going to fail you is on. It's not going to be able to understand the context of a request to say Eric should not be able to access Nikki's documents or whatever, right? Those are business logic flaws. Can you start to build these into your unit tests? And most of the frameworks, if you're really relying on this for high test coverage, you're going to have a test that says, let's log in and access your portfolio or access your documents that you've uploaded. So really, you just need one more inline data statement here on line 3 that says, let's log in as the same user and try to access Shaniqua or Shanice's records, okay, under username 1 instead of 2. And that should result in an unauthorized. So instead of okay, we should get 403, you're not allowed to access that data. And that's as simple as that can get. And you just start to build that out over all your endpoints that should be performing entitlement checks and things like that.
Now, do you ever see this being used with like workload identities, service accounts?
That's a really interesting progression there, which that could be pretty fun, because we all know cloud IAM is very problematic in the cloud space. Mm-hmm. And that could be a very nice application of this to say, let's make sure that, you know, maybe our cloud identity is appropriately scoped and, you know, I can't go access S3 data, you know, for some other account or maybe some other bucket in the account that we shouldn't have access to. All of that could be done from in here, just using the standard cloud provider SDKs and things like that. That's pretty interesting.
Yeah, a bit of a leading question.
Yeah. No, I mean, I'm immediately thinking like that could be a whole nother hour discussion of how could we apply this to, you know, cloud IAM permissions and things like that, which is pretty cool. Let's see. This has come up a lot. So just data validation in general. I know Nikki asked some basic fuzzing ones, and Seth's whole project is dedicated to just not putting evil data in the system and making sure that we kind of smoke some of that stuff out. So I just threw a generic, this is one field, mind you, this would take a lot of work to cover every parameter across the entire system. This is where we fall short and DAST is going to kind of pick up the slack for us. But if you have super important fields or super sensitive things that you're really worried about, it's not difficult. If this is me just throwing, you know, some instance metadata SSRF payloads into the system. And this is where Seth said, let's just look for the super basic things here. You shouldn't really ever have, you know, a 169, 254 being stored in a name field. You shouldn't probably have the Google Compute metadata. You shouldn't have less than, greater than, ticks, semicolons, etc. 5 or 6 test cases here would make sure that we've got some good validation on that name field. And we should be getting 400s back on those. So that's what that should look like. You shouldn't be trying to redo what Zap's doing inside of here, if that makes sense. We've got to draw that line somewhere. All right. Let me pause there. I know we've got about 10 minutes here before we're hitting the top of the hour. Did that help glue some of our conversations together on what those can look like? And
yeah, definitely. I mean, if you go through the ASVS, there's a lot of content in there that you could test against. So I feel this is a really good kind of way to start the process here to build that kind of memory or process into the org, because this isn't just something that happens like once and done, right? This is a continual kind of like, this is our journey. We have to do this. This is why we're doing it. This is what we're trying to solve for. And you have to kind of build out this entire process here.
That's why I like the penetration test kind of feedback cycle too, because if things are leaking through when you've got all of those other controls in place, this is the perfect way to solve those, because we're just missing them. Assuming you've got good pen testers doing it.
There's a comment question in the chat from Mal Explorer. Who is actually responsible to write these unit tests on the application? That's really the...
Yeah.
Should it be the developer, or should it be a security person? Is it a combination activity? What's the best practices here, Eric?
Well, you know, that's a culture question, at least is what jumps to my mind first, right? It completely depends on how your org is structured and how comfortable your security folks are working with the dev teams. You know, how embedded are they? And based on the question, it sounds like not very embedded. So maybe let me switch over to my, I'll show you how at least I set up the, so I'm going to flip over to a security/ASVS branch where I just threw all these tests in. And the way that I organize them here, let me flip over now. I should have some security tests. They're different directories. So I put all of the ASVS security testing in a completely separate directory inside of, let me get rid of this other stuff. And you'll notice they're all named, you know, ASVS and the requirement. So that's really only going to mean stuff to security people. And my thought process there was I probably would have the security team own these if they're truly writing them and they're truly sending pull requests into the repository and saying, hey, I added 5 new security policies in here. Have someone on the dev team review the pull request and they can approve it. And it's kind of out of the development team's way, right? There's this whole isolated playground for these unit tests and they've been validated and et cetera, et cetera. In an organization where the security team's not comfortable doing this, it's probably the dev teams that own them. And maybe the security team's just working with them, I don't know, let's just say 30 minutes a week, something like that, saying, hey, we want to work on this failing security policy this week. Can you help me write this? And then they might write it and they might be the owner of it. But it kind of just depends on culture, I think, overall. Tough one to answer.
Yeah, no, I agree. It definitely is org specific and, you know, whoever wants to own it, right? It depends. Some orgs, devs want to own this, and some orgs, security wants to own this. So,
exactly. Ideally, both are involved. I think that's the one commonality that we would have, because it's probably not going to happen otherwise. Usually you need involvement from both sides to get it working.
Any other questions here? Let's see. I love Scotty again. I love using ASVS to show devs teams, especially PMs and product owners, what AppSec covers and what we don't. Time, comma, resources. They typically ask, quote, was everything tested? And it's hard to give a guarantee. This helps sets up the next conversation. That is true. Yeah, it's always good to have a standard that you're testing against, so you can kind of come up with some relativistic, you know, coverage map here. Yeah. Otherwise it's just endless.
It makes for a great threat modeling discussion too, to be honest. And that's something I think is also underutilized here is, you know, does security get that 10 minutes of stage time every Monday morning during the sprint planning for the week, right? You know, can we talk about what's changing and how it might affect this little ASVS matrix that we've got put together and things like that? So
it also gives you kind of language, right? With your security team, your compliance team, your dev team, everybody's speaking the same thing.
Yep, absolutely.
There's a general question.
Go ahead.
Yeah. It's really around how do you get into testing and QA testing? And I guess maybe getting into this work where you're actually writing QA, you know, unit testing code. Is it better to start as a developer or start as a sort of security pen tester? Sort of a very general question on how do you kind of gain the skill set?
You know, it's different for everybody, I think. And usually it's just about having that curious mindset, I think, is really the only prerequisite there. I don't think it matters if you're a project manager or a dev or, you know, a security person right now. It's all about just what can I learn next to help me solve a problem. And so if you're on the dev side, you're really just learning to solve some security problems. If you're on the security side, you're learning how to use dev to solve some security problems. And, you know, it just takes time and focus, I think, and collaboration with folks that might understand the piece that you don't better to get there. But I know a lot of very talented development folks that now are full-time pen testers. And I also know a lot of full-time pen testers that now write a lot of infrastructure code and DevOps code and things like that to help get better and more efficient at what they do.
Totally. Cool. I think we've gotten through all the chat questions.
Right on. So a couple minutes, I won't, if you check this branch out, just kind of tying off the demo side of things. So what all you really need to do, if we run a .NET test again over here, in .NET REST, that's what I wanted. You'll notice locally they're failing. And that's because all of those ASVS checks that we just walked through in the slides, you know, our JSON web tokens aren't signed. We've got some missing validation. Our Tinkerbell password is getting through and registering for the user. And you can see, I think, so we're up to what we start with 11 tests. This now through 28 different tests at it, 15 pass, 13 are failing. So we've got some things to improve on our little Puma Prey API here. I did wedge this into a GitHub action. Oops, let me get to the browser here. So I've already run some of these things. So you can actually see, you know, as you get into the CI/CD piece of things, we've got the test results format here, and you can kind of get that high level data. And here's what I've got failing, you know, at the moment. You can see the feature ones are all good, right? Those are the happy path test cases. You go down to the security section in that security directory, and you can see we've got a little bit of work to do to improve those and get those things fixed. So that's at least a baseline to start partnering with the dev teams with and saying, hey, we can go harden this a little bit and get some tickets opened and start to fix those things up a bit.
Yeah. But
all that's out there in the open source repo. And this is really, I had one more meme. I think that was the only thing that was important to show before before we break here is make sure that you turn the test on in CI/CD. Typically, you're exporting those to a common JUnit or .NET test XML file format that the pipeline can parse and display for you. So that's all in the slides. And we'll just kind of leave this up here.
Yeah.
At least the summary. I'll open it up at this point.
There's one more good question here from one tall lady. Based on your review or your quick review of ASVS, what would be the top three specific unit tests that you would recommend to target based on known gaps in the SAST and DAST world?
Yeah. You know, I think we covered the authentication piece pretty well. And, oh, one sec.
It's funny, real life happens. That just happened to me just a second ago. I had little puppies running in.
We almost made it to the end on a Sunday before the kids are like, are you going to feed me today or what? I think authentication configuration is up there in my top three. And also the entitlement access control piece is also in my top three.
Yeah.
As far as the third one, yeah, I mean, those are where I see misses all the time. Usually it's humans that are finding those. I'd have to probably look. I don't know. I can't decide what I think.
You could probably spend a whole bunch of time on just authorization tests, like IDOR style kind of problems and, you know, entitlement gaps. So yeah, I agree. Those are good maybe business logic problems.
Make that 2 and 3 because you're going to spend a ton of time there and try to identify those and figure out the best way to test for them for sure.
Cool. All right.
Yeah. Thank you, Eric. That was great. Just a quick question. From all, you know, during this show, we've talked about different activities that we do throughout the SDLC. This doesn't seem to be the first thing you would attack. When is your team ready to take that next step and do unit security testing?
Oh, that's a great question. This is an advanced control on the big matrix I showed up front. And it takes time and it takes dedication and it chews up a lot of resources, to be honest. So if you are resource constrained on your security team, this probably isn't where I'm starting. You know, get some basic code editor, you know, security linting in place, get some lightweight static analysis in place with some of the open source tools that are out there. Start running some basic, you know, unauthenticated spidering and dynamic scanning with something like Zap or Burp, et cetera. Those are all things that are relatively more simple to set up and get really, really, really good at those things before you start to take on some of these more advanced controls.
Yeah. And I think it's important to mention because we keep talking about the best practice and do this and do that. And it can get really overwhelming. And just understanding that this is not, you know, the first thing you do, and you probably want to start with threat modeling and start knowing your tools first and that you'll eventually get there.
100% correct. This is a years long journey if you're starting from scratch, right? And it's not something that you can just kind of snap and say, we're going to do all this stuff overnight.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that answers the next question we had, like DevSecOps says, given constrained with security resources, how should security teams rate values of security unit testing, SaaS, DAS tools, or similar value? Where should you spend more time, money, and resources?
Yeah. Well, you know, the best part about the ecosystem is you can do all this for, you know, a $0 cost at this point. There's so many great open source tools out there with static analysis and dynamic that you start with those. That's where I always say, if you have nothing today, start with those and just get a baseline data set for where we're at. You can always, tools come and go. We can swap tools in and out whenever we want. You know, you don't have to start with this big fancy vendor one that has a million bells and whistles on it if we don't know how to run the basic open source ones first. So that's kind of that maturity model, I think. Start slow and work your way up so you're not overwhelmed.
Makes sense. So let me start wrapping up. I just want to mention, if you don't know, that we have a team in Australia, a bunch of new hosts, and they had a show on attacking JSON Web Tokens. So if you missed that, that was Friday night for me and Saturday morning for them. Check out our YouTube channel. All the recordings of our previous shows are there. And also coming up next week, we have Neil Mathis-Hall. I hope I'm saying that right. Account security beyond 2FA. So the best way to keep track of what's going on is to be in our meetup .com group and also on or any of our social media platform, because we announced it there. So a lot of thank yous and great presentation in the chat. Any last word for anyone from any one of you?
Well, this was great.
Yeah.
Thank you all for having me. It's great to get to chat with you for an hour. Hope we found some interesting things to explore when we head back to work in the morning, right?
Yeah. Awesome. So we'll let you feed your kids. Okay.
Get it done.
Awesome. Have a good weekend, everyone. All right.
Thank you, everyone.